All right, a very good evening to one and all watching us live on Facebook. And today is a very, very interesting session because this is the start of a brand new series called the COVID Talks. And this series is all about kidney warriors fighting COVID. Well, with so many questions and with so many emotions that a lot of us in the community is going through, I'm sure this series is going to bring a whole lot of difference of how we as kidney warriors fight COVID and come out extremely strong. And this is our first episode, and today I have with me Dr. Santosh Varghese, who's got more than 10 years of experience and currently in CMC Vellore. Well, born in Calcutta and most of his years in Vellore. Well, if it could bring a smile on your face, I also got to know from Dr. Santosh Varghese that he went to school with Ganguly from class 1 to class 10. But remember, you cannot post any questions on that one point when you ask questions to Dr. Santosh. Well, on that note, I'm going to request you, wherever you are this evening, to please give a big hand of applause to Dr. Santosh Varghese, as he's going to be taking us to the enhanced safety measures that we should follow during this critical period that the world fights COVID, and what should be done, especially if you are on the journey of CKD. On to Dr. Santosh.
Hi, can you please allow screen sharing for me, please?
Yes, Tom.
I hope my screen is visible now.
Yes, Tom.
My topic is enhanced safety measures for staying safe. And when I looked at the statistics a couple of days ago, actually, it's quite alarming. And today I happened to look at them up and they've gone up by a few notches. We know that our country especially is going through a very bad time. Number of people who are falling sick are increasing. Number of people who are dying are many. So in troubled times like these and the daily headlines, this was very true last year, the numbers came down, and again, every day we have highest daily increase in number of patients. And it doesn't look like there's any end in sight. And our question is, what are we going to do? So I hope to look at very quickly some of the basic things that we know and should be doing already, and what more we can do as we go through this problem. So it's no longer novel to us. We've had this for a long time, and this is why it's called COVID-19. Although the symptoms are pretty classic, but not all fevers are COVID, and a lot of COVID is asymptomatic. Now with the new Lancet article of showing that SARS-CoV-2 is airborne transmission, it makes us even more need to be careful of people who do not have any symptoms. So if you have a doubt, we need to visit at least by phone or telephone or by email your friendly neighborhood doctor, and rest at home or quarantine. We'll talk about it. So we may, or people around us may be shedding this virus into the environment, and that's why we need to be careful. How can we be smart and safe? The most important thing, and I cannot emphasize this more, is washing our hands. And actually, the question is, am I washing my hands correctly? We all know that we must wash our hands, but are we washing hands correctly? We have a small video showing how we ought to wash our hands appropriately. So We need to spend about 15 seconds washing our hands, and some of the areas that we might miss are the spaces between our fingers and the thumb, the top, the back of our thumbs, and in between our nails. These are areas that we need to be careful about, which may harbor infection. This is true for all infections, not just for the COVID. So what do we do if I'm not able to find a tap and soap? We need to use an alcohol-based hand sanitizer, which we need to keep handy. This is something that I cannot emphasize more, that we need to be obsessed about using hand sanitizer. Be obsessive. There again, ways of rubbing it and onto all parts of our hands, and that is exactly the same as we would do for hand washing. Keeping our nose and mouth, I apologize for the spelling mistake, is covered is very important. The cloth mask is probably sufficient, although there are reports, as I said, about airborne transmission. The cloth mask is still probably sufficient, but we must wear it correctly. I have a few pictures of how people are seen wearing it. We may have seen this around in our community about how people wear it not so accurately. And this, I think, is the most common scene in our community, where people do leave the house with a mask but don't wear it consistently. So it's important for us to wear the mask at all times, all the way up, close the bridge of the nose under the chin, and keep it tight and snug without having any gaps. So touch only the ear loops. Don't touch the mask after wearing it, especially the outside surface. Don't touch it. Don't touch your face after touching any surface. It's important to know that mask is meant more for protection of others from our droplets, although it does protect us as well. But most important is for protecting others. Physical distancing without having emotional distancing. We need our friends when COVID is gone. So while we need to keep a physical distance, it's important that we relate to them appropriately. So 1 meter is what everyone has been saying. The other thing is to practice cough and sneeze etiquette by coughing not into our palms, but into a sleeve or onto a tissue or a handkerchief. This is to prevent other people from becoming sick if we are so. And the next thing is to not to touch any part of our face, because our hands may be infected by touching a surface. Therefore, don't touch nose, eyes, mouth. Be very, very, very careful. Other things are, where we work, surfaces where other people may have touched objects like our phone, our laptop. Therefore, we need to make sure our hands are clean after we touch anything. Avoid meeting people who are sick, because we don't know who may be harboring. In general, it's better that we restrict our activity to people who are within our household, encounters from within our household. Outdoor sports are a no-no, except for things like IPL, where you have a bubble, where although people have started doing various things by themselves just to make sure that they are quite active rather than just playing video games on their phone. So staying safe and healthy is prevention is better than cure. We know all these are standard things, and these are not new, and they cannot be overstated. So it's important to protect ourselves and others. But a few other questions. Can I work from home? The answer is yes, I must try to stay at home. It becomes difficult. And when we need to travel for various things, we need to go to various engagements that are unavoidable. And therefore, we need to maintain the decorum of wearing a mask as well as keeping your hands clean. So where things are essential, either for buying things or for work-related things or socially where we have to go, we have to go, but we have to take the precautions. If you know somebody has fever or is coughing or sneezing, you need to stay away from those people because they may be harboring the infection. Because a cough or a sneeze sends out more organisms every time the cough or a sneeze happens, and therefore it's important to stay away and important that they wear a mask as well. If they are wearing a mask, then it's less likely that they'll send it out into the atmosphere. This is something which is very difficult to do. If there are any surfaces, especially surfaces in the house where somebody comes in or something from the outside is bought, and I must admit that I don't do it consistently, wipe down all surfaces with bleach containing products or just bleach mixed with water. We don't have to use a sanitizer for this. We can, but we don't have to. Just a bleaching powder mixed with water is quite sufficient. As patients, we need to see if we can keep an adequate stock of drugs so that we don't have to go to the pharmacy when it is crowded. Now, our hospital, during the lockdown, at the tail end of our lockdown, CMC had made an arrangement with the postal services where if somebody were to mail us with a requirement for their drugs, one of our patients are saying their drugs are run out and they're not able to come, the postal services were sending them the medicines after we prescribed them, and our pharmacy would arrange to send them by speed post. And our pharmacy said if patients are buying medicines worth 1,000 rupees or more, the postal charges are waived so that the patients can get their medicines at a good price and without having a problem, without missing their medicines. What about public transport? I personally like public transport, but I think at these times, we have to be very careful that we don't allow a touch our faces after we enter a public mode of transport where we might infect ourselves. It's sometimes inevitable that we do travel. What we can do is if you're on a train, like I recently had to travel. So what I did was use some of the sanitizer and wipe down the seat I was sitting on, where I was lying down on. And when we touch a surface, wipe up, be obsessive about using the sanitizer on the hands to prevent our own infections. And in our community, we need not have to say it, but I just want to say it that should not spit around and with potential infection spread. What to do when a family member or a colleague has COVID? Now, this is something which is becoming very alarmingly close to all of us. Somebody has COVID, what do we do? So the answer is stay away from that person. However much we are fond of that person, so as not to infect ourselves and in turn infect somebody else, we need to stay away. Either we stay strictly isolated or the person has to stay strictly isolated within our homes. And again, I can't say it more often than I can't say it most often enough. Be obsessive about using the hand sanitizer, even at home, if somebody is unwell. And absolutely no compromise on health precautions. So when a family member, CKD patients who are in transplant patients are vulnerable. So if you think you have an infection, seek medical help. It is better to test and know than to worry. Sometimes people wonder, there are some test centers are saying testing is a waste of time. We don't have adequate testing facilities, I know, in the country, but it's still better to test and know rather than worry. So you should make no compromises. Supposing you have one of you gets COVID, God forbid, what do you do? Should you go to the hospital? Well, if you have symptoms, yes. What about when there's bed shortage? That's a problem which is facing our country in general, and there is no easy solution. What I think people are now forced to do is triage, and the sick patients get admitted, and the not so sick patients with mild symptoms are at home and they are followed up over the phone. So as I said, home quarantine is a good remedy. If there's little or no symptoms, can be safely at home and just take paracetamol, steam inhalation, just to keep your symptoms down. And anti-allergy pills if you've got a runny nose. Any other drug to be given, taken only if your doctor advises it. Don't be a pill popper. No over-the-counter drugs. Some of them may be harmful to you. So only if your doctor advises it. Patients on hemodialysis, do not reduce the frequency of dialysis at any point. This is, I think, where patients of peritoneal dialysis are benefited because they have the luxury, if I may put it that way, of doing dialysis at home without going to the hospital. And they can be completely safe of interaction, of mandated interaction that is forced upon patients of hemodialysis. hemodialysis patients do not reduce the frequency of dialysis. Now, I must say this with a little bit of experience. Last year, when the pandemic set in and there was lockdown, our patients were finding it difficult to come. And we decided to reduce the frequency of patient dialysis from 3 to 2 for all patients. And some of the patients who required thrice a week, who did not tolerate twice a week, were having symptoms of shortness of breath when they came in. And we were forced to, when those patients go to thrice weekly, and then we went back to the regular schedule quite quickly. And we realized that our plan was not a uniformly feasible one. It's very important that at no point is any medicine skipped. Do not skip any medicines, especially transplant patients. Do not miss your medicines. Even if there is infection, do not miss your medicines. Now, your doctor may recommend increase in some medicines or decrease in some medicines, like we do for our transplant patients who have been infected with SARS-CoV-2 virus. We have done various minor dose modifications or medications. That is the doctor's prerogative based on your medical condition. Do not do it on your own. Please consult your doctor before any changes are made. If you feel breathless, do not wait. Do not wait. Go to the nearest hospital where you can be evaluated. You need not wait until you meet your nephrologist. It's not like a patient who on dialysis is short of breath and says, okay, I'll go to the doctor tomorrow because that's my dialysis day. You should not wait. At least you make sure that you're okay. Go to the nearest hospital emergency where at least an assessment is done and your oxygen saturation is recorded and you're told whether you can wait or you should be evaluated, because some of the shortness of breath that you may experience may be just the fluid or the low hemoglobin related to chronic kidney disease. Some of it may be related to a possible infection. Don't forget, our other infections are still around. Bacterial infections are still around. Other infections cannot be ignored. It may not all be COVID. So do not wait until you meet your nephrologist. All the doctors who are working are there to help the patients. But when you go to a doctor who is not your regular doctor, please inform the person about your pre-existing condition so that they can consider the implications, especially drug interactions, and if there are drugs to be avoided. If any crucial medicines have been changed or stopped, please update your nephrologist so that you can take his or her advice about this matter. There's a new thought which has been taught to people about how to handle their breathing. So patients who are short of breath are taught, and now this has come as the Government of India, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare guidelines as well, I believe, on how we can do prone breathing to improve the air supply in the body. Now, this has been done consistently for patients who are in hospital while they are on oxygen. In the hospitals, this is being done. But patients who are only mildly short of breath, who don't require oxygen, who are at home, you could still change positions every 10 to minutes to half an hour and change your position. You can do them in cycles. Obviously, you can't do it all the time, but this is advice to improve the amount of oxygenation done in the body. The last is, to quote the words of Jesus, help those in need. There may be plenty of people around us who need help, including people who are sick, who need to go to the hospital. We need to make arrangements for them. We may not be able to go physically, but all that we can do, we must do to help those in need, because we also may be in need of help at some time. So to conclude, safety starts and in a sense ends with ourselves. We cannot depend on anyone. All our health systems are there to help us, and they all work only to a point. Sometimes, as we can see, they can get overwhelmed, like we have now, where our health systems are getting overwhelmed. So we have to take responsibility for what we do. And don't worry. We trust God for our help, and may God bless you all. Thank you very much, and I'm open to answering any questions that there may be. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Santosh, for that wonderful presentation. And we got to also know a lot of information that we already probably were following as a protocol post-transplant, but a few little tips of how to do it more precisely so that it will actually make a difference in our safety during these difficult times. And Doc, some of the questions that I've got live are questions that you probably already answered, but I'm still going to take it as a live question. But before that, I would just like to inform the community that Dr. Shyam Bansal is not joining us today because he has been tested positive and he's resting, but he will be joining us in our next session. But however, questions that have come on the vaccine will be taken to Dr. Shyam, but we'll also have Dr. Santosh give us his perspective on the questions. But just because we're taking questions on the vaccine, I'm going to request the community not to bombard us with too many questions on the vaccine, because this session is not based on the vaccine. Instead, it's based on the safety measures. I'm going to request you to please cooperate with us so that we can have a free-flowing session. Thank you. So on to the Q&A. First thing somebody asked us is, now that hospital beds are not available, how can we manage? What are the safety measures to be taken by COVID patients and their families? So when we call, let's understand the case study. You call, we don't have an hospital bed. What is it, do you think, that we should first be doing, doctor?
So you've given me a bouncer question to start. Now, this is a difficult question and there's no easy answer. I think the first thing would be to try and contact the various hospitals to at least get yourself triaged to know how necessary it is to be admitted. Now, it's only those who require oxygen typically who require admission. The first wave, the country's policy, the health policy was to initially at least was to admit everybody. And soon, I think everyone realized that that is not a feasible option when all the hospitals became overwhelmed. So this question, if it is like hospitals are full and therefore I need to be admitted, well, most people thankfully don't need to be admitted. That's first. So I think that fear we need to take out of our minds, that because if I get infection, most people don't get admission, don't require admission. Most of the doctors who are infected in the hospital, in CMC, or the medical staff who've been infected are not being hospitalized. Most of them are at home and on quarantine. They don't require hospitalization, therefore they are not admitted. So that's one, that's the most important. So that's 99%. Now there's a small percentage who do require oxygen. These, I think, we have to hunt high and low for places where oxygen is available. And in my class WhatsApp group, there are people in the community who are arranging oxygen cylinders to give oxygen by mask to keep patients comfortable as required at home. Now, there again, it's not, we don't get, should not get, if at all we reach a situation where the doctor says you need oxygen and therefore take oxygen, you shouldn't be, I mean, patients shouldn't be taking too much oxygen, because oxygen actually in high proportions is harmful, can be harmful to the body. So the minimum amount of oxygen required to keep the saturation, I would say targeting 95% saturation, remembering that the oxygen saturation probe machines that are commercially available, many of them are not medical grade, so they may not be very applicable. So the feeling of suffocation being dealt with, and about a 95% on would be my personal take on it. Of course, there is no guideline specific to this question.
First and foremost, I'm so sorry. We're starting with a tricky question. It popped up, so I just answered it. But
no problem.
But I like what you actually said, Doc. The fact of not panicking and being in fear, I think most of the decision making, so most of the need to go to the hospital can, I mean, at least a certain percentage could be eliminated if people stop panicking and thinking, oh my God, I'm done with COVID and I'm feeling a little uneasy. I think at that point of time, we could also try the position of sleeping that you mentioned to kind of maintain the oxygen.
Yeah. So if anyone feels short of breath, that prone breathing, that lying down, face down. Actually, there are, you should read it up, you should put pillows under ourselves when we do it. That is something which people can follow so that they can oxygenate their lungs better. That's easily doable at home. Yes.
Great. And so you got that information that in case you don't have a hospital bed here at home, most of the patients may not need a hospital bed, but if you need one, you'll have to look at one. But the first thing you don't do is you do not panic. And if you have accessible to some oxygen around you, maybe you can use it as a temporary solution at that point of time till you move to the hospital. And Doc, we as a community have been also working along with doctors, and we have a setup that we're trying to help the community get accessible to medicines, oxygen. So you can just reach out to us itself, and the team is readily available to help you out. So that eliminates another part of not panicking, because we are together in this. Okay, the next question that came up is very similar to the first question. In my family, two people are home quarantined, forcibly, as hospitals were not admitting them. We are recovering well, but my husband has CKD, got COVID. How can I manage him? He's also diabetic. How can we protect the children?
Okay, so if I understand the question correctly, there are two patients recovering. There is a CKD patient who has COVID, and how to keep the children safe. Now, obviously, if the children are too small, it'll be difficult or not appropriate for the person who's infected, mother or father, to look after those children. They have to be quarantined. The children will have to be forcibly kept away for medical reasons from the infected persons, because we want to keep them safe. On the other hand, the good thing is that children generally don't become very, very ill with the SARS-CoV-2 infection. So that's a good thing as well. Now, the thing about the CKD patients is, because the immunity is low, their risk of becoming infected is higher, and sicker may be higher. So I think, again, the threshold for getting them to a hospital should be based on, again, even mild symptoms should be seen and documented that they are actually okay in terms of oxygen saturation. The things like what fever and all can be managed with just paracetamol and regular other stimulant for symptoms of nose condition, etc. But the shortness of breath is where if they have to go to a hospital. There's and what we discussed in the previous question, there are no other way out. The only extra part is that patients who are immunosuppressed are at higher risk of becoming sicker, and therefore may require to be in hospital earlier.
Thank you, Doc. Doc, for our regular, during this period of COVID, what is your view on our regular routine checkups for transplant patients? Would you recommend that we do it? Of course, while doctor answers this question, please note you would have to take this question back to your own nephrologist. While Dr. Santosh is a professional, we're going to request you to please consult with your nephrologist. We're just hearing Dr. Santosh's perspective on this question. For a regular transplant protocols, would you recommend transplant patients at this given point of time visiting hospitals to do their routine blood checkup?
So that's a very good question. There are various things to just seeing a transplant patients. Somebody who's had a transplant in the recent past, like a month ago, 2 months ago, their follow-up needs to be more strictly monitored. So blood pressure monitoring, blood sugar monitoring can be done by the person at home. They need to get their labs tested at whatever frequency the transplant program has. And it must be done in a reliable center. The reports must be followed up by the transplant team and communicated as to what the decision might be. Now, for example, if there's a rise in creatinine indicating that the transplant kidney has a problem, that has to be evaluated. And that evaluation, if we compromise and don't evaluate, the patient may actually be hampered. So there are some things which are non-negotiable. They need to come to a hospital. And the hospital is not necessarily a more infected surrounding than the community at this point of time. You have to maintain the same precautions everywhere. And I'm sure the transplant team also will be, you know, obsessed about making sure that the patient does not get infected. But so there's no answer to say, no, stay at home, don't go to the hospital, because that might be counterproductive. So if the hospital requires you to come in, if there's a worsening of creatinine has jumped from 1.2 to 1.4, or need to repeat the test, of course you need to go to your doctor and get their advice.
Thank you, Doc, for giving us your answer and views on that. Doc, at which point of time we know that our saturation is still manageable, and when do we go to the hospital, and when we take this to the next step of knowing that this is serious?
So, see, although 93 is probably a better answer, I would say 95 for our the small pulse oximeters which people have at home. I would say 95 would be better. Or if the person feels short of breath. Now, shortness of breath is a very subjective feeling, and some people may feel short of breath even without a problem. Yeah. And some people may not feel short of breath, but they may be hypoxic. So I wish we could say, because 90 is a threshold for giving oxygen. 93 is probably a good enough threshold to go to the hospital, but I'd say 90, less than 95 on the commercial one would be safer. That's a completely personal opinion.
Would this number be the same for dialysis patients, transplant patients, and a person who's a caregiver and not on CKD, Doc? Or why are you giving?
I think roughly it would be the same. Well, we could argue that the hemoglobin isn't as high in a dialysis patient and so on, but I think for ease of operations, the same number would suffice for everyone.
I have this very good person who's given me a question, because this person this is exactly how they worded the question. I practice hand washing, I wear my mask, I work from home. How more can I protect myself against COVID? I think they are pretty much following all protocols.
Anyone who's living on the planet right now is at risk. And I said, we have to trust in God to keep us safe and healthy. I don't think there's anything more than what the the Ministry of Health guidelines are that we can do. But there's still a limit to what we can do. But we must be obsessive about the guidelines that are advised. Yeah.
Thank you, Doc. I'm going to take a question.
I must say something here. I must tell you about an elderly lady who does not step outside the house, does not have any visitors, but she washes her hands with the sanitizer every half an hour because she heard it on the TV. Now that's carrying it a bit too far. The hand washing is to be done for people when you have an encounter with, if you have not just stepped out of your house and there's no one coming in, I think we do not be as obsessive as that.
Doc, talking about safety measures for people who want to continue or have a donor and want to do transplants, what would you have to say? Do you think it's the right time to go ahead and still have your transplants done, or you think you'd want to suggest safety measures, let's take a break for 1 month? What is your view on that, Doc?
So right now, the number of cases are increasing. Number of positivities of patients is increasing. Number of asymptomatic patients being positive are increasing. Patients who are preoperatively tested are being found positive even without symptoms. I think in general, this may be a time for us to stay off transplantation until we see at least a plateauing of the numbers or a decrease in the numbers, in which case we can actually do it more safely.
Thank you for that answer, Doc. I'm going to take one question on the vaccine. Can dialysis patients take the vaccine? When we go for the vaccination, what are the precautions we should take? And those who have sugar, those who have high BP or on blood thinner medications? Can I say the second half of the question when we're done with that?
So I'm open to more vaccine questions. So in general, the guidelines are very clear. And for dialysis and transplant patients, everyone and normal healthy individuals, everyone who has access to the vaccine, please take them. Whether you have got diabetes, hypertension, whether you're on any medications, take them. Patients who, if you think you might have an allergic reaction, like some people rarely do, hang around in the waiting area for a few minutes, up to a half an hour, some places they say, so that you're make sure that you're okay and you go. Like our hospital keeps people waiting for half an hour. But in general, the principle is take the vaccine. Now the question happens is like, will it do me any good? We don't know. But it may. In general, the people who have the vaccine and who get infected, the numbers are very small, but they do get infected. But in general, likelihood of becoming sick seems to be small. So I would say take the vaccine, no questions asked.
Doc, is there a right time to take the vaccination for a dialysis patient before they go, or maybe on the 2 days off of a dialysis? Is there any?
It doesn't really matter. Okay. It doesn't really matter.
There was somebody, it didn't come as a question, but I remember I was discussing it on the group where someone did mention, if I take the vaccine and then go for dialysis, won't it get washed out of the system? No,
the dialyzers, the membrane is not sufficient enough to allow these protein particles to go through. So short of treatments like plasmapheresis, the vaccine will not get removed from the body, no.
Okay, so which means this is a very good answer for me, Doc, because I always thought there was a best time for dialysis patients to take it, to do it maybe on a Friday when they have a Saturday, Sunday off, I was assuming.
The best time is as early as possible.
Okay, great. Thank you for that, Doc. The next question is, can a transplant patient take the COVID vaccine? If yes, any precautions? What are the side effects to be monitored? Because different doctors have different opinions. What is your view on the same?
So I think the Indian Society of Organ Transplantation has guidelines are available on the internet now. And what the society has said is, please take the vaccine as soon as you have access to it. Now that 18-year-olds and above are likely to have access to the vaccine, I think everyone should just take it. It's not a live virus. So patients don't get COVID with it. There was always a fear about what the vehicle or the vector can do. I think most of it has been, because initial days, there weren't enough studies. Hello, am I online?
Yes, Doc.
Am I online? Have I been lost?
Doc, I can hear you. Hey, Doc.
Am I audible now? Am I audible now?
Doc, you're audible, Doc.
Yeah. Yeah. So as I was...
Yes, doctor, I can hear.
Yeah. As I was saying, patients with transplantation are not at any risk of infection with taking the vaccine, and they should just take it. There was a concern initially about whether they can continue immunosuppressive medications while taking the vaccine. And the answer is yes, they should continue the immunosuppressive medications and not stop them for the sake of the vaccine. Hello? Yeah, I can hear you now. Please tell me. Yeah.
Doc, I must. brings us to the end of the questions that we have. Somebody's asking us one more question. Part of the safety measures, do you recommend them taking supplements like vitamin C, vitamin D, or zinc? Will it help in their immunity?
I think, am I audible now?
Yes, Doc, you're audible.
Yeah, I think I'll keep my video off. There isn't any proof of vitamins or minerals improving the risk, enhancing the immunity against the virus. But in general, that it can't do any harm. Most of India takes inadequate proportions of minerals, is what I understand from what people have said in general, although I've not seen it documented. So it can't do any harm. But it's not a sure shot measure to increase immunity.
Well, that brings us to the end of our Q&A. So wherever you are seated this evening, I'm going to request you to please put your hands together for Dr. Santosh Varghese from CM Bellore. Take time out of you to join us. Spreading us so much of love, awareness to the community. On behalf of the community, I'd like to say big thanks, Doctor, for joining. I'm sure the session is going to make a little chill with you. I'd make some time. And before I come to the end of the session and let Dr. Santosh sign off, I'm going to remind you guys, remember, while we are professional, Dr. Santosh talking to us, he may not be your personally examining nephrologist. Whatever information you found interesting in this video, the one thing you could do is you could take it and discuss the same with your nephrologist. No tapering of medicines, no changing of lifestyle, no changing of any protocols that you are asked to follow by your nephrologist should be followed based on this interview. So that's all I have to say. This is me signing off, wishing you all a very good evening. Stay safe. Do not fear. We are in this together. I'm sure we're going to come out stronger. And I'm going to let Dr. Santosh sign off on those notes.
Thank you very much. I think my video was causing a problem sometime.
Yes, doctor. Thank you, doctor.
Okay. Bye-bye. Have a nice weekend.
Bye, doctor. Thank you. You too.
Thank you.